It's a great pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of the workers. I will refer to the public discourse forum in JNU for different issues for the last 1.5 years. And we have organized many talks on hostel meals, post-dinner talks, training talks on the daytime different schools on different issues from international to the economic policies to the environmental issues. And today we are here to for a new experiment that I think it's never been happened by any forum in JNU to organize the interesting sessions to how to publish a book. That's very important because we all are right now talking in JNU to have a publishing house in JNU, on publishing house in JNU. It's very important for us to first know how to publish a book, and the topic is today how to publish your first book. Really, I think, fascinating topic. And today we have Devasri. Rakshit is commissioning editor of HarperCollins India, and Devapriya Roy. Devapriya Roy is ex-student of JNU, and she is also author and columnist. She has written two books. One is The Way Women Send Book. I have recently purchased this book, and the other one is The Weight Loss Club, published by Rupa and Co. And the other book is being to published is on project based on heat and dust. So it's travelogue type of things that is co-authored by Devapriya and her husband, Saurabh Jha, and he's also the student JNU. So, it's really a big pleasure for us, and I request Devapriya to coordinate the session.
Thank you,
Adi,
and it's
fact
a very honor for Devashree and I must thank India First, Ajit and Abhinav, for inviting us this afternoon. And I have to tell you, I have been on the other side of the committee room. Right? So I know how nerve-wracking it is to be on this side. Because, I mean, these are really clever guys, you know, these guys. And when we used to be on the other side, is to really judge these papers. So, you know, we have to be on our guard.
Do not worry.
Not to worry?
Not to worry.
So I suppose it's got mellow over the years. I spent 2 years in this school. The School of Language and Literature and Culture Studies. I did my MA here. And these were two of the most intense periods of my life. I think I read far too much, that was good for me. And it put me into the habit of reading far too much, that is good for me. And I got married. My husband is also a former, is now again back in JNU student, with no idea what we were getting into. So very intense. Very romantic, I would say, and very foolish period of my life. I'm glad to be here, and I'm glad that I have with me here today Debasri Rakshit. She's a senior, she's a commissioning editor at HarperCollins, and she's going to tell us how to go about publishing a book in India today. But more than that, she's going to talk about the publishing scene now, she's going to talk about being an editor. And so welcome Devashree. And I must say that Devashree is from Jadavpur University herself. And she was about to do further studies on Lacanian thought and psychoanalysis. Very, very, very intellectual stuff.
But then I slipped into publishing and I couldn't get out of it. So hello everyone, thank you for coming. It's a great pleasure for me to see with so many people. So many of you have turned up. Can you hear me properly?
Yes.
So basically, I have been in publishing for about 5-6 years. I used to work with Penguin Books before, and now I am with HarperCollins Publishers India. So that's that, and they will be attending to the first question.
So my first question is, should you want to talk a little bit about the publishing scene right now? Because I remember when I was growing up, when I was still in school, when you thought about Indian writing in English, the narrative was always about big advances, getting David Godwin to be your agent, or failing David Godwin, at least some other equally cool London agent. And the nerve center of Indian writing in English, serious Indian writing in English, was London. Fortunately now, I think we can definitively state that Indian writing in English is now Delhi-based. And I think there's been a huge there's been quite a paradigm shift. Do you want to talk a little bit about that? How Indian writing is very much located in India now, and it's the readership in India that is what writers target. So, and I want to also sort of bring in the question of, you know, can we actually say that Indian publishing has a before Chetan Bhagat and after Chetan Bhagat, much as the Indra and I think that, but can we actually say that?
I would say that Indian publishing has come of age in the last 3-4 years. Even 5 years, 6 years back, we didn't have as many publishers as we do now today. We have at least 6-7 major publishers in trade publishing, and a lot of academic publishers who have set up their branches in India. Which also means that this is the first generation when we have such a huge English speaking audience who can read English books. I would say that initially when publishing started in India, we used to look to the West for references, for America, London. In the last 5 years, even the CEOs, even some years back, even the CEOs of, say, a publishing firm like Penguin used to be someone from abroad, a white guy. But now that it has been a shift, there has been a great shift in the sense that there is a huge audience out there in India itself, among urban India, even in tier 2 cities, who read books, who read English books. Though I would say the kind of readership that we have in India is different from the kind of readership that you have in the West. In the sense that, in the West, in London, in the United States, people read a lot of fiction, stories, literary novels. But in India, the target readership is still towards non-fiction. People reading, using books for different kinds of guides and knowledge.
So rather than reading as an end in itself, reading is as a means to an end.
Means to an end. That could also be not only self-help guides, but also a lot of books on politics, current affairs, books on international relations. So information.
So Divishi, are you saying that HarperCollins India is selling far more non-fiction?
Far more. In fact, 70% of our list now is non-fiction. And 30% is fiction. That's we have had to balance this out in the last few years because we found that is where the sales are. Also, regarding the question on Chetan Bhagat, it is not fair to run him down.
It's just grapes are sour.
What happened is, publishers, actually the best way, the way we work is that, create different imprints for different kinds of writing and writers. Because maybe a literary writer wouldn't want to be clubbed with Chetan Bhagat, but Chetan Bhagat does get you the money. As a publishing firm, we need to make money.
Just to sort of, complement your point, a couple of days ago, there was an article published by Arunabha Sinha, where he did an analysis of what Indians are reading. Now, what he says in the very first point is that he says that when a new Chetan Bhagat book comes out, the top 500 Indian writers at that time in the market, Chetan Bhagat outsells all of them put together.
Yes, he does. He does. For a book like Chetan Bhagat or for a book, a popular fiction, people publish 60, 70, 1 lakh copies at the beginning. And all publishers are looking for that kind of a person who is going to make money. So I think Chetan Bhagat is necessary for a publishing firm in the terms of business. But publishing is not about selling a water bottle or a cup of coffee. So you have to also do books that you believe in. So those are books that editors take on, even though they know maybe it will do 2,000, 3,000. But those are books that you push out into the market and you hope that people will read it by word of mouth, the word will spread and that people will like something new and different. Because otherwise you just become, just stereotyping, the kind of Bollywood movies that we make every day. So that doesn't make sense. We have to make them for some business, but actually the serious kind of writing is what we as editors like to push. Like, and that is the kind of books that we do, a lot of them. Books which don't sell, but books that we believe should be there out in the market. The voice should go out and people should listen to it.
So just to sort of, continue talking a little bit about popular fiction, I think there have been two responses to the Chetan Bhagat phenomena. One is that a very large number of young authors have emerged who see themselves as entrepreneurs rather than writers. So, you know, so we, the purists, we always saw ourselves, we saw writers as people, you know, who would work in silence, in quiet corners, who would struggle and would kind of, who were a bit fascinated with the idea of failure. And suddenly this breed was confronted with a brash, jargon-savvy, MBA degree-holding bunch of writers who, you know, who dazzle, dazzle you with terms like, you know, so this book is a product and what are the new, you know, so they'll say a book is a product and the rest of us will be shocked, but what then shocks you more is how many books these guys actually manage to sell and how they manage to reach newer and newer segments. But I think your publishing or what you have done is you have remained, I think, slightly clear to...
Yes, that's also because they haven't found us yet.
Okay.
No, but then, see, we do publish, like, all our literary fiction, like, for the state. We, the kind of popular fiction that we have tried to publish is also a little quality.
That is exactly what I was trying to say, is that, with, say, something like Anuja Chauhan, you're breaking new ground within popular fiction because it's very intelligent. It is not merely reinforcing stereotypes, it is also challenging.
Yeah. Yeah.
And within using the frame of popular fiction very effectively. So I suppose that there is a lot of interesting things to be done, even within
the genre, there are a lot of interesting things to be done, and we are publishing those kinds of books. And yes, you know, these guys have redefined the game, whether Amish Tripathi or Chetan or some of the others. They are looking at book business as business, and so book writing, which used to be about the author and creativity, has, with publishing firms also coming and agents coming into the picture, which have become more about the business, you know. So half of a book, you know, just editing and creating is not enough. You have to market it, you have to sell it, distribution. So all that has come into the picture, but I still think that there are many good writers out there who are being sold, who people are taking, you know, people are reading. People like you, in places like JNU and in other universities who are well-read, they would like to go for the better kind of writing anyway. So those are the places actually we as publishers should also target. Like, that is the target leadership.
So do you want to actually, you know, if we actually take the question head on, if any of them want to publish a book, whether it's a novel or what should they do? What would be the way to go about it? In the West, I think mostly it has to be through literary agents. In India, publishing houses still accept manuscripts directly. But there are literary agents too. So do you want to sort of tackle all these questions?
So the literary scene in India, the literary agent scene in India is still at a very nascent stage. There are only 4 to 5 agents, and they are not 1/4 as powerful as the ones in the West. So basically the way agents in the West, you know, 90% of writers actually go to the agents who then represent them to different publishers and get them better offers. Here, that's still not the case. The thing is that if it goes through an agent, it goes through one layer of editing or one layer of, you know, someone looks at the manuscript, but actually it doesn't make any difference for us editors. If the book that is coming from you, from the author, is good enough, then we do the editing anyway. So we would welcome any manuscripts that come to us from you. We are always taking manuscripts, like you can email one of us and we'll read the manuscript and get back to you. If it is anything which is, basically what we're looking for is a new spark, creativity, whether it's a story or writing, even if it's an old story, if you're selling it in a new way, or if you have something, if it's a work of non-fiction, if you're actually doing something new in that field, there is a lot of things which are still unexplored in all different kinds of sectors. You know, even with fiction, there are an infinite number of ways to tell a story. And I think that new authors who have come, who are writing in the literary scene, they are still, I would say, a little conservative yet. I think there are many ways you can break out. Like if you look at French literature, they have been writing for many generations. They're not breaking out. They're doing so much of experimentation. I think our writers can experiment much more.
So basically, Indian writers in English can and should experiment much more. Even though the market will remain. Is a niche sort of market. Of course, I want to say that just to add a layer of realism to this, you can send them a manuscript. They're going to take months and months to
get back to you. Sincerely, we don't. We have a slush file which we check every 2 or 3 months. All the editors sit and do. But if you send directly to an editor, that person usually responds within a couple of weeks.
Oh, okay.
You know, that's all we do. We respond.
Okay. I'm really impressed. So shall we then say that it's very likely that if an idea excites you,
yes.
But would you still say that you want a proposal and 3 chapters? Do you want to explain that, you know, when you're looking, you get so many proposals and you're rushed by this, there are so many management. What is an effective proposal?
I think an effective proposal for a piece of nonfiction would be as crisply up if you can talk about the subject and give us 2 or 3 sample chapters to get a sense of the writing. For a piece of fiction, it is more difficult. Sometimes I think, you know, the synopsis may not be enough. Then you should ideally give a lot of the chapters that we get a sense of the plot, the writing. Basically, what arrests an editor or the editorial group when we go, a lot of us read the same manuscript actually, when we sit in a group and read it, is the style and the language. You know, if you read the first paragraph, the first 2 pages, you can understand if there is something new, something arresting, something which you have not read before. That is what actually arrests you.
So then at the end of the day, the advice to all who want to write, as well as all for writing,
I would say, just let me interject, is don't write for the sake of writing because you think, but write when you really feel that you need to put it down on paper. I think there's a huge difference between that. Chetan Bhagat, I think even the first story that he wrote, that was about his life. You know, later on he took this up as a business model. But I would say the first piece of writing should be coming from within you. When it is honest and when it is as true to you, then you become universal. I think that's the idea of a fiction. Because otherwise, you just get into formula and you think you can replicate X, Y, Z, but it never happens that way.
And just to add to that, I feel that you really have to read and read and read. Because if you train yourself to understand your own writing better so that you can actually judge your writing, I think that is extremely important. And for that, I think reading is the key.
You have to read good literature, the best ones in the field, and then...
And also, I suppose the genre that you want to write, so if you want to write, say historical fiction, it might be a good idea to sort of, delve a little deep into...
There is another thing which I think a lot of people write, but we're not able to publish much, is poetry. We are actually the only publishers who are still publishing poetry. We do 4 or 5 poetry titles a year, more than that. Because poetry gives us very few revenues actually, in terms of revenue, they're very highly priced. Maybe only 1,000 people read it, but we still publish them. That is another field that I know that a lot of people, it comes from within poetry, but we are unable to publish. That is one regret, I think.
So why don't we do something, Devashi? Why don't we take a first round of questions and then we'll continue talking. Do we have any questions? It can be anything. And please tell us your name and department.
Yeah, I'm Sandhus. I was a student of the School of Language itself, from Center for German Studies.
German Studies?
Yeah. My question is, it begins with an absolutism that there are things which precedes book writing and then there are things which succeeds book writing. For example, there has to be publication and word of mouth publicity and organized publicity. Now, I heard it from Rajiv Malhotra that there still exists a regime of denial. For example, he was never invited in the Apple Literature Festival and all such places. So, can you please elaborate on that?
So, we are in JNU and we have been reminded right in the beginning that it is very important to consider the political. Do you want to take that?
I think take that on, then I'll add something to it.
Well, of course, you see, what I was going to ask Devasri, and then I was being polite and I didn't, I thought I'd be saving for the next round of questions. That is, when you are, when you get a manuscript, do you also consider who the author is or marketability of the author?
For some books, you know, for a book like, say, where it is not a great piece of literary work, but you have to look at the marketability of the author. Because you're not, then you're not doing something which you believe in, but we are doing for business and marketing.
Of course, writing, the case of Rajiv Manojra, I will tell you, Santosh, it's very interesting because even Vivek Debray has said this, that there was a way of, you know, but of course, Vivek Debray was also published by Penguin. And Rajiv Manojra, incidentally, has been published by HarperCollins.
Yeah.
And I will tell you, incidentally, the good thing is that in a publishing house like HarperCollins, I know for a fact that the publisher, Kartika, what she says, that even though she may not personally follow the ideological ramifications of a particular book, she would like to represent the entire
Yes,
book.
We do not do that. In fact, we have published a couple of biographies on Mr. Narendra Modi, which are completely different. One is completely flattering, an Andrew Marino's biography, and there was another one which was very critical. And we have published them in like a span of 2 months. So we do not take sides, and luckily we are a publisher. You know, the people we are financed by are in the United States. They don't look at. You know, for example, there are a lot of pressures on publishing firms. There are a lot of pressures on news channels to toe a certain line, but we don't have to. And Rajiv Manojra has actually done very well. On the other hand, you know, some of the organizers of festivals, they may have certain
festivals, of course, yes. They are sort of, some of them are cabals.
Yeah, and really festivals are not any kind of way to judge an author. Because anyway, the readers don't know who the festival organizers are, how many talks that person is giving. This is an additional thing, the festivals. And there's also, festivals are a lot about networking. Some of the festivals like Jaipur, they have brought really good writers from the West at different points in time. They've got them to speak. But I would say it is fine if someone is not speaking at a festival.
But anyways, Rajiv Malhotra has been invited for the Jaipur festival next year.
Change of regime.
Change of regime, maybe.
Well, do we have another question?
I'm currently pursuing my PhD for the Center of Studies, and I'm not aware whether HarperCollins is into the publication of academic books, but I wanted to know what is your criteria before publication for the academic book, and how do you rate feasibility? What are the do's and don'ts?
See, largely, as far as I know, HarperCollins is mostly a trade.
We have our Collins Education Division, which has recently started 1 year back, which was academic books, but we have started mostly with school and college textbooks as of now. I think they'll move to academic books. But yeah, we largely do trade books. But I know that there have been authors who have come to us from academic publishing firms like OUP and other places, professors who have published with us. Simply for the reason that, you know, a trade publishing firm has a larger reach. It just goes out to many more people. Maybe you have to simplify the language of the subject a bit for the general public.
Too academic.
Yeah, you know, academic terms maybe you have to explain, or like Irfan S. Habib, we did his book, Jihad or Jihad.
Deepakar Gupta.
Yeah, we did one by Professor Manu Bhagwan, who resides in the United States and is called The Peacemaker. And we have done several. We welcome those pieces of, we completely welcome that, but we are not an academic publisher.
And of course, when you look at academic publishing houses, you have a whole range now, again, working out of Delhi. You have OUP, which has the oldest of the presence in Delhi. You have Routledge. You have Cambridge University Press. You have Sage and Macmillan. So there are many.
Black Swan,
there's
a lot of Orient Black Swan is the best possible.
There's Permanent Black as well. They have a very select list. So it's worth pursuing. Perhaps you can look at their websites and you know, send them a query. But if it's a book that is not exceedingly academic, then I think perhaps even
trade publishers, you can apply, you can send to other trade publishers.
My name is Siddharth. I'm a student here at the MPhil program in Spanish. Am I audible at the back? Okay, so I'm actually interested in knowing about translations of books published by HarperCollins. Now, you know, if I give an example, like if I would like to translate a book into Spanish, a book which has been originally written in English and published by HarperCollins, so would HarperCollins be looking at, say, a market in Spain or in Spanish-speaking countries in South America who would be interested in, readers who would be interested in reading the translated text of, say, probably an Amitabh Ghosh? I already know that there have been a certain texts, there have been a couple of texts of Amitabh Ghosh that have already been translated. I don't remember who is the publisher. So how do you see this working out? Have you been able to, you know, maybe see this market of translations?
See, what usually happens is that the books which are translated into foreign languages, usually our rights department looks at them, and you know, because our distribution is limited to the Indian subcontinent. Recently, we are moving into something called the Harper 360, for which our books will be available across the world. But these select languages like Spanish or German or French, these are best left to French publishers. You know, what we can do is look for the right kind of French publisher for a translator.
Or a Spanish publisher.
Or a Spanish publisher or whoever. And then look at someone who will have the distribution in that area, you know. So what we do is sell the rights for them, which we've been doing all the time.
So now I have a follow-up question on that.
Yeah.
So if I'm able to find a Spanish publisher who would be interested in publishing, getting it translated, so I'm talking about now the monetary part of it, if you can throw some light on it. That, so where does the translator be in the monetary transaction? Does he get a royalty on that? Because I'm pretty much a layman in this field, so I would like to know. Or he gets a one-time payment as a translator on the book, and he has no further role to play in further copies that have been, sold.
I think both are done. The more famous translators would actually share royalties 50%. Whereas, you know, a lot of publishers, for young translators, they would probably just pay a one-time.
But I think mostly now translators would get a percentage of the royalties. And usually the publisher who takes on the translation would pay you. Like the Spanish publisher would actually pay you, make the payments. But you can talk to the author, if the author is still alive, you can talk and negotiate the rates, like what percentage you would want and what percentage that person would want. But I think royalty sharing is very common now.
Thank you.
But this is actually... Sorry.
I don't have a mic.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. I'm not a student of JNU, but I'm associated with the university since a very young age, when my father was working here briefly. And I came to do research here. I was at another university. And I've known people, and I know people at CESP, the Center for Economic Studies. I just wanted to share, I mean, this is just by the way, it's like some of the economists, Krishna Bharadwaj, Utsav Patnaik, and many, many renowned economists here, they were very, very popular, and they were required reading in my university, which was overseas. And when I did my research, so I came and met some of these, Krishna Bharadwaj, of course, but Utsav Patnaik and Jayati Ghosh. So it's a wonderful thing. One of the ideas I get is that somebody should write. I mean, all of you are here, is by the way, is of the academic history of the JNU.
An academic history of JNU is being written and is being published by HarperCollins.
I mean the ideas of some of the very good academics and to translate them into simple language and so that it reaches out to the mass of people and the kind of things that happen in sociology, history, economics, you know. That's just an idea.
No,
that's not my question.
Okay, and I think it might also be done in fiction.
It's a matter of, you know, things like the serious historian would not consider, like, to be politically incorrect, I would say that perhaps Professor Romila Thapar would not write for a trade publishing firm. She would think an historian like Ramachandra Guha is not a historian. You know, so these schools exist, and I don't think academics would want to dilute they wouldn't really want to dilute their ideas and work, and so it depends on the person, you know.
So again, to button, I think fiction is the answer. We need to have that great JNU novel. When is the great JNU novel?
My question is to Pop.
Okay.
My question is, we have very few, we don't have a culture of literary agents here in India, largely. But I also feel that we don't, and you have to tell me about that, maybe I don't know, it's just a guess, is that we don't also have a culture of good editors. For instance, if one of these people, including me, and I'm an aspiring writer, is if you want to write a work of fiction, rooted anywhere about anything, but we send you a manuscript and you say that's good or it's not good. It's likely, I mean, I would assume for myself that you would tell me it's not good. Because you know style, you know, you've been reading, you know style, you know language, and you know what sells, right? Now, but then there's also something which I think is quite very well established, institutionalized in the West, is that you get very good editors. You can pay editors, of course. I mean, if your work is not being accepted, then somebody can sit with you and they can teach you writing. And which is, I've written for the media simply because I was doing something in policy, so they saw me as contributing for that. So, and I also worked for the Hindustan Times briefly. But then I'm not very happy with the editing culture, even in our publications, the in-house newspapers, magazines. You have editors who will take a manuscript and work on that.
No, so there are two or three different questions that you raise. Now, there are all kinds of editors. One is that publishing houses themselves. So when you talk about the leading publishing houses, the editors they employ are some of the finest editors that I have ever met. They are fabulous. But of course, they are not going to do the particular job that you are talking about. So these editors who work for the publishing houses, they will only start working on a manuscript if it has been accepted. However, there are now editorial services available where if you want to polish your manuscript before sending it to a publishing house, it can be done. In fact, the big example is Amish Tripathi. In the preface to his first book, he acknowledges
even Chetan Bhagat didn't write it himself. He had someone else writing his book for him.
Okay, I hope you can afford a lawyer if he sues you.
No, I think he mentions some yeah. Yeah. So even a few years back, you wouldn't be having so many editorial services, but now you have editors. You don't have agencies like you have in the West. Where even I heard that even D.H. Lawrence used to go to an agency and get his manuscripts published. So, but you have a lot of standalone editors.
And of course, I would just want to emphasize that as far as the newspapers and print media is concerned, and editors of publishing houses, there's a world of difference. You know, so that's because of the pressure of deadline, and I think fewer editors, there are mistakes that creep in, and perhaps there you can, say that.
No, that's not true of magazines
as well. But with books, it's a very, I think,
this is not physically possible for us to actually go through that, because, if the manuscript is already not in a certain state, then it's very difficult for us to actually do that kind of work, that kind of groundwork, which has to, if you think that you already have an idea, even sometimes we have taken on authors for which we felt that the idea is good, but that person cannot write, and we have suggested some editors for them.
And the final, I think, element in your observation is that, where I would agree with you, perhaps we do not have creative writing courses, that many creative writing courses under the aegis of universities. That is perhaps something towards which we are moving. I do remember that in the MA program in English studies, sometimes Professor Makarand Parathwe used to offer a semester of creative writing, but we in India are a far cry away from an MFA in creative writing or in translation, as there are many universities in.
But Jadavpur University has one course in translation, one course in creative writing.
One course in translation we have as well.
Okay.
But I meant a proper MFA program, in writing.
Yes. I guess that like HarperCollins will accept someone if they're good. But in order to be good, they have to have someone hand-holding them and telling them, everybody needs
but
to.
But now, you have editors who actually do that.
And in fact, just to sort of say this, The author Anita Nair, I think, is just beginning or is about to begin a mentorship program in Bangalore, where she's going to do exactly this sort of mentor writer.
Anita Nair.
Anita Nair, yes. I think she's doing fiction, non-fiction, short story. The whole range. So that's worth a look. I think
that is one thing where we should actually look at and see. I think more and more as writing becomes more popular, we will have more agencies which will be focused on.
But there are a few, and I think it's also possible for you to hire a freelance editor to help you polish up your manuscript. That is also done. Do we have any other?
Hi, I'm Rakshit. I want to ask that is writing about imagination or it's all about penning down your own life story? Like when you talk about the young authors, right? They don't have much about, you know, they have not faced the harsh realities of life, okay? So they only imagine and they create visions of imaginations like that. So is writing about imagination, it's all about like what you have faced, you penning.
I think, what Devji was saying earlier, the first novel in many cases is autobiographical. And everybody borrows elements from their own life, but somehow you have to use imagination to transform it into something else. So it's a process which is very difficult to talk about. You know what I mean? It's doing things. It's difficult to explain, what you do with a good book. I mean, when it comes to me, I can talk about myself. My first novel was very autobiographical. My second novel was not autobiographical at all because I was tired of sort of, telling everyone, people would actually come and ask me, did that really happen to you in exactly that way? And the thing is, it never does. Even when you're using autobiographical material for fiction, it gets transmuted into something else. And then, of course, my second novel had nothing to do with me, but I'm sure the deeper currents are drawn again from one's own life. But it's a very important thing that you say, what about experience? What about hardship? Or what about generally, So that is a very important worry for a lot of authors, and which is why sometimes, when we say that the metropolitan novel has become rather boring, we need to work very hard to get excellent material. So, which is why writers sometimes rely a lot on research. And some writers, they open themselves up to a very wide array of experiences so that you have material. It's kind of a mix.
To add to that, I would say if you've read all the great writers, you will find that your suffering has been transmuted into a work of art. That is what you do for great writing. I'm not talking about the business kind of writing. So that is the case with any artwork. Your experience, your pain, your suffering, your happiness, it is not what you put down on paper, but you transform it, it is a form of sublimation. Whether it's music, whether it's painting, whether it's writing. So, the better you're able to do it, the better artist you are.
And just to sort of add to that, when you say pen down your thoughts, you assume that there is an element of control, But writers have again and again confirmed this, that when it comes to a book is not in control of a writer, I want to give the example of this American writer, Annie Dillard, who writes very, very powerfully about the writing process. In her book, The Writing Life, she says that writing a book is like taming a lion. So she says it in the context of actually working on the book every day. So she says that when you're taming a lion, you have to go there every day. And if you don't, then if you go for 5 days and then you don't go on the sixth day and then you go back again, you're back to zero. So, you see,
it's different for different people, actually.
It's very
for example, I remember Javed Akhtar was asked this question. So for poetry, you drink, you think, and you just pen down. And I said, no, you know, you imagine poets are like that, but it's very disciplined and hard work. You actually have to write, then you have to rewrite 100 times to put it in that format that you put it in, especially with poetry, which requires a lot of discipline. So yes, I would say that is where, you know, you transform your emotion into a work of art is basically your self-editing. When you have written something down, then you look at it and you look at it again after 2 months, 3 months, and when you're satisfied is when you send to a publisher.
And then after it's published, you find that you hate it. You cannot bear to
read it. The editor's job is exactly, it's exactly, you know, the place, because a writer is very close to their own world. So the editor's work is basically a detached eye, which can look and say that these things work, these things don't work, and sometimes it's very difficult for a writer, because those are words which have come out from within him or her. But overall, that's how an editor and a writer actually work together to create something.
And therefore, it would be no exaggeration to say that when we look at, you know, very great writers, what we do not see is that all of them had behind them very great editors. I'm sure that is true. We had another question then.
Yeah, I do have a question. It's just
yes.
Feedback. You know, I've been a student of JNU in the past 7 years. I mean, the first few years I was looking. I mean, I'm an MPhil student. We're both classmates. And it's just a comment, you know. It's, you know, I think you mentioned in the beginning of this lecture that I just want to say that I love JNU. I think he's making India read like never before.
Yes.
And I think I have a lot of JNU acts. I've read Edward Said's Orientalism and I've read Chetan Bhagat. I like that guy more than
Edward
Said.
Of course, a lot of people actually relate to his writing.
And he showed, you see, that is why I asked her whether Chetan Bhagat represents that breakaway epoch that you have before Chetan Bhagat and an after Chetan Bhagat.
See, the important thing is he can connect. As long as you can connect. It works.
And he also showed the depth of the Indian English readership. Because before that, I think if a book sold 10,000 copies, it was considered a huge. 5,000 copies was a great success. But I think he was able to show exactly how deep the market is.
I was, in fact, yesterday I was reading Amit Chaudhary on Chetan Bhagat. Amit Chaudhary happens to be an established writer, a literary person. He also teaches at a British University of East Anglia. Quite a well-known person for history and what commentary. But then he says about Chetan Bhagat that Chetan Bhagat had no burden of a form, a style.
Yes,
he
exactly.
Began on a clean slate. Yes. He didn't just start writing.
No, and the other thing that liberated him was that Chetan Bhagat was writing for an Indian audience. You see, this is what the writer Manu Joseph has called the corrupting influence of the West. When you look too hard at an audience that is away from you, then that has had a corrupting influence on Indian writers, and that is where all the entire breed of brash new young writers comes forth, because they don't care, they didn't come from literary departments.
And it's not in a way bad, because it's just increasing the readership. And then when there is a readership, then you can do things with the readership that give them better books to read. But first you have to build the readership. Like for example, Harry Potter, I think Harry Potter, J.K. Rowling made a generation of kids actually read books. No one was reading books, they were just playing video games.
Even adults, I think.
Yeah. So I think these books are necessary, and if they're able to reach a chord, if they're able to connect, that is good enough.
My only point is, you know, just to say that I was joking about it when I said that I hate it. What I really mean is that, you see, popular fiction is extremely important, because as you said, how many people are going to read Edward Said? A very, very small number. Hundreds of thousands of young people read Chetan Bhagat, which is where a burden of expectation also comes on him. And that is why, in say, for example, the context of his last novel, I will just take this opportunity to say why I had a bit of a problem with it. The reason is that he raises a very important question, and the question is about, you know, he talks about the non-English type. I don't know if you've read this, novel, Half-Girlfriend. No. Anyway, he raises a very important question about what is the role of English, the access it gives, etc. Very important questions. However, then, you see, the hero, he apparently learns English in order to speech to Bill Gates so that the Gates Foundation saves his rural school in backward Bihar. I had a problem with this politics, right? So that's where I'm coming from. I write popular fiction myself, and in fact, the first time I read Chetan Bhagat was in JNU. In our MA, we had a course called Globalization, Literature, Culture and Society, and we were actually taught one night at the call center. So I'm trying to suggest a deeper reading into this. I'm saying that the responsibility then on Chetan Bhagat is huge, because the access he has with the youth of India is immense, and therefore it becomes very important what he's saying, you see.
But I think the same goes for people who produce films like Himmatwala and Golmaal.
Happy New Year. Exactly. Yeah. Which is why Three Idiots was considered such a breakaway. Yes.
Read them, but don't take them seriously.
Exactly.
There's a fundamental question. If you're a writer,
yes.
Why write? Like, Jabo Sartre, for instance, why write? Why do you write, after all? Now, if you have Panchtantra, doesn't mean that you don't read, people have not read Panchtantra. But you can't read Panchtantra and expect that you do a Mahabharata for it. So, both it, but then you don't. The point is this, that distinction one has to make. And I'm not saying that he doesn't have right to the right to write, and we don't have right to read. But then, and the point is this, that when you talk about he should take responsibility, I think the moment he starts taking responsibility, he would not be what he is.
Yes, and the other, but you see, that's the problem. In the preface of this current novel, Dhananjay, you see, he's written.
The kind of volume that he wrote on the Northeast, let's say.
Right.
Some of his statements.
Right.
And you can't take them seriously.
No, and the other thing is, what he's written in the preface to this last novel has a very pompous preface, okay? And he says that, you see, when I began writing, I began writing to make it, okay? So the idea was to make it. Now I write for change. I write, so he is taking on the responsibility, which is why it becomes even more important that, he think it through. What is the message that he's giving? This false American dream and American charity, I was quite offended by it. That's my Please continue.
If you look at Enid Blyton, for example, she was very racist. But we have all read her when we were growing up. We didn't notice them. So every writer, I think, will be set in their own milieu. They should take some responsibility. Even popular writers should not propagate serial lies.
Well, especially if they are actually stating that, they are a fortune. They are writing for change, and, it's a mighty pen. I've heard him say this. So that's why I'm just being wicked. We are going to now stop talking about Bhagat and talk about other things.
I like him as a smart guy. Yes, are there any questions? There is only one or two things I wanted to add in the context of several things that were said. One is, in the universities that we are currently studying, the courses, we don't have anything on contemporary writers, especially English writers. When I was in Devapriya University English Literature, I knew that I used to look down upon them, and I thought they're no good. Maybe only one Salman Rushdie I read, I used to look down upon Amitabh Ghosh a lot. And I still do not consider him a great writer, because ever I think that but it's also one way of writing a novel, where you're gathering a lot of information and research into Amitabh Ghosh's novels, and then he creates a work of art. So there are different ways to approach a novel. The question that you asked about creativity, that is one way of writing a novel. And the other thing is that universities should encourage reading of contemporary fiction. We have stopped like 20 years back.
Oh yes, of course. The connect is going to be so much greater, including let us study Chetan Bhagat, I have no...
At least the more literary ones, in the market there is Arvind Dhaliga, there are others. Let us try and read them, because if we don't put them in the curriculum, at least in some place, we just think, in the last 20 years only, we have written nothing of any significance.
Yeah. Right. Do we have...
Okay, then your question.
Hi, I'm Devika. I'm the faculty of my master's in literature. So, my question is about the first book. So, what have you said that inevitably we end up writing, we end up adding along autobiographical elements to what we write. So, my question is around that, because I have also come from the same thing. When I write it, it's absolutely impossible to actually avoid those details. We may use our creativity, and it may become the boundary between fiction and So even if you're drawing certain elements from your life, then you might just think that this is exactly what happened. So my question is, do you accept, first, how do you deal with that? And second, do you accept anonymous manuscripts?
Do you accept anonymous manuscripts?
We can accept anonymous manuscripts, and we'll ask the author for their name later. We don't deal with it, you know, as editors, I think it's very important to have the kind of detachment, as I said. And this is something I think if you ever enter the world of publishing, you find that sometimes editors get too attached, or sometimes editors get too into what is being written. It is the author's work. It is about the author. So you can write about your life. It's only that when I think that I'm editing, I have to be a little gentler, because you know it is about the author's personal life, and you have to use tact, basically. But I think it is welcome if you write about your own life. We would encourage that.
And then, another question was for you, that how do you deal with it?
Well, I suppose it's a bit annoying, but
no, you're not being called a big woman.
Oh, but that's the idea.
Yeah,
I think it also becomes a part of the identity.
And what happens is, in writing the book, you also exorcise many things
exactly.
About that
you
that time.
Yourself, yeah.
Then you know, in my case, what I did is I used humor. As something that helped me deal with a period of time that was, you know, that comes across as much funnier in the book than it really was then. I think, but then what happens is, after you've had the first book out of the way, and you get all these questions, and I think maybe it helps with the marketing. I don't know. But for example, my husband was asked very many times that, you know, are you ugly? In fact, just the other day, somebody actually, you know, was inviting me for lunch, someone who had read my book many years ago and then eventually got in touch, and she said, you and Abhi must come for lunch. And I'm saying, who's Abhi? For a second, I'm actually asking, who's Abhi? And then she said, why, your husband? I said, today he's not Abhi. Abhi is the character in my book. So that has happened, and it can be funny. But I think once you have the first book out of the way, you start
to... But let me tell you, sometimes we edit out a lot of stuff. Sometimes some of the main writers, you should see the sex scenes they write. And we understand these are autobiographical fantasies, and we cut them out. So this shouldn't go to an audience, yeah.
But don't look at me like that. They think it was me.
No.
Okay. But,
that was one question. Yeah, I have two questions. What is how much are publishers interested in publishing translations from Hindi or Marathi or other languages? I know that Penguin publishes some translations, and they have sold 5,000, 6,000 copies, and they say that it's a huge sale. And how much is HarperCollins interested in doing South Asia? I don't know how much South Asian writers is HarperCollins.
This is, these both are very good questions. What is your name?
My name is Dinesh Kakoli. I'm from the Center of English.
Okay. Do you want to take this?
So we have a Hindi list, a Hindi publisher. We do around 15 to 20 Hindi books a year. A lot of them are translations. Some of them are translations from English, some of them are translations from other regional languages. And we have been pushing the Hindi list. Even a few years back, they weren't doing very well, but they are. The market, there is a huge Hindi reading market. We don't do publish in the other languages, regional languages, but we encourage that. Any good piece of writing in Hindi. Now about South Asian, it's also the same question about Spain, you know, it becomes a matter of rights. So if we think a book will work, something, a story which has universal resonance, or a book which will work for India, we just take on the rights and publish that book.
But I think, you know, I would say that perhaps this is an area in which, especially, well, South Asia, actually, you find Bangladesh and Pakistani writers quite a bit, because many of them are published by Indian
publishers.
Yeah,
Pakistan almost
exclusively
published them in India.
So, but I think to kind of add to his question, I think it is true that very large, we'll get lots and lots of writers from England and from America
from the West,
in our bookstores, and we have Indian writers as well, but for the rest of the world, it's really a big blank. So I think this is something in which, you know, publishing houses are yours to license a wider variety of books.
So some books, for example, even lovers like you and I, by Minatri, it's out in Turkish.
Hmm.
You know, so we are exploring that.
Turkish books, other than Palmer, who had to win the Nobel for him to be available in India.
What happens is also, you know, we have to look at the market now. Because of Western media invading into our lives so much, we relate to that kind of society and that kind of writing.
So we are obsessed with the Anglophone
world. But
something,
for example, which is coming from China, I wonder how many people are going to read it. So if you think something which has universal resonance, sometimes it could even be a work on non-fiction, you know, something about administration, which we have done,
yeah,
so on Beijing or on Indonesia,
yeah.
Which will
even the rest of Europe. I mean, we have so many.
We don't have them actually.
So I think this is a very important area, and I think the new age publishing.
And what we try to do is not sell them as translations, but look at them as new works. You know, for example, when we read the classics, Dostoevsky or whoever, we didn't look at them as translations. We just read them as books. That's the same we are trying to do for translations.
Yeah, for instance, I'm from Nepal, so there are really good books from Nepal.
Mm-hmm.
If I want to translate them and publish in India, what is the market? Like, what is the acceptability?
There is a market. You can approach publishers and see, but we have done several books from Nepal, Bhutan, Northeast, Tibet, Burma. Actually, a lot of them are these.
And in fact, recently I attended a SAARC summit where of culture ministers, and this was one of the things that they actually tabled and discussed, that, you know, that there should be far greater interaction and you know, a dissemination of books from the rest of South Asia into India. But I think it's true for all, you know, large parts of the world. But maybe, hopefully, it'll change. And the good thing is that with Kindle and with e-books now, you can effectively actually change that. It's possible to buy books in a few seconds.
Yeah, and we have also online sites like Flipkart and Amazon selling books. We get more than 50% of our revenues from these stores. But they have actually revolutionized the game. You don't have to go to a bookstore. Bookstores don't have to stock your books.
And it'll take time, but you can actually get books from other parts of the world sent to you. So that has changed the game as well.
Yes. Yeah, I have a question. I'm from Center for Linguistics. I don't know if you're or not, but I was wondering, like, if someone begins writing, so, like, how long a book should be in terms of its length, and maybe how long it takes usually, like, whenever.
See, it depends on the book, but I would say the average length of a book is something between 50,000 and 70,000. 50,000 and 70,000 words. For a work of non-fiction, which is hardback, we would look at a little higher number. You can write a 40,000 word novel or a novella. 50,000 word would be the standard, and it depends on you how long you take, but I would give an average of 6 months to a year for a person to write a book, or 8 months.
For a disciplined person.
I just want to ask about the non-fiction writing. You know, some of the non-fiction writing do take a lot of research to do.
Yes.
Some may take field works and all. So do the publishers sometimes fund these kind of books, or we have to on our own?
See, what happens is the funding is part of the advance. You know, when we are paying that advance of the royalty, 50,000, 1 lakh, 1 lakh, 50,000, we expect the writers to take care of it within that, because the research money should be coming from that advance and the royalty that we pay. In very special cases, for example, when we have suggested another special editor to go through the book, we sometimes add that costing. If it is some money, we just add it to our costing. And what happens is that the more money that we spend on a book initially, the higher the cost of the book, you know, because we have to recover the costs. So, if the author is fine with, say, a book priced at not $2.99 but $3.99 in order to make up for the money we spend, then we can. If you think that that is viable, then we can.
I just remembered, I have read this book. I just walked out and I have read your book, and I've read it in one go.
Oh, thank
all
you.
2 years back. And how I got it, doesn't it? This is the same story about having passed over, married, and then your husband.
That's right, it's called the Vague Woman's Handbook. It's about the friendship between two women, two very vague women.
Going back home, Calcutta, and accepting.
Yes.
I think what the reason I really liked it was that I had a sense that it had a kind of career about it, kind of JNU about it, a sense of that, and I know JNU, so I could relate to that. That's just one thing. The language was very good, and the most important thing is that I don't want to get in stagnation, those things, I don't remember it now. It could hold my attention, and so that I would read it. So I remember books for holding, so that's the thing. I recall I've we've known, and I've been part of the same kind of circles. How did you write your book? How long did it take? What kind of editors did you get? How many times did you revise it? Was it done in one go? And who are the people who are not inspiration in the sense that you're somebody, I mean, maybe your husband's abuse or something, but I mean, people who work on the structure and style and practically help it to see life.
Right. You see,
what kind of support did you get, and what can you tell us about that?
Okay. So, Anurag, the thing is, you know, when I was growing up, I didn't want to be a writer, but I always thought I would write this really tragic, really serious book, which nobody would read, but which would be really literary. And then fortunately, you know, just I think after my MA, one of my mentors, Professor Deepanjan Rai Chaudhary, he told me that, you know, write your the book later. You know, write something now, something fresh, something that you feel strongly about. And I had just finished reading Advaita Kala's Almost Single, which is a book that HarperCollins had published. And I thought, well, this is a voice that I like. This is fresh and this is Indian and it's fun. It's such a fun book. So I wanted to write something fun, but at the same time, I knew that I was doing popular fiction, but I wanted to play around with the rules a bit. So mostly in popular fiction, you have single girl looking for love. And here in the Vague Woman's Handbook, you have the opposite. You have somebody who's already got married. So what next? So he's not looking for Mr. Right, but probably looking to survive Mr. Right or whatever, that way. So some of those things. And as far as structuring, I think I was fortunate that the book got commissioned early. So I had some kind of confidence in writing it. And I didn't revise it too many times. You see, I'll have to let you in on a secret. There are many writers who do many, many drafts. Unfortunately, I'm the sort of writer whose deadline was like 2 months ago. So therefore, I do not have the luxury of doing many, many drafts. So in all the three books that I've written, one is going to be published next year. I've done one draft, and while editing, it's during the editorial process that we've done all the tightening.
With an editor.
So I've had a very good editors from HarperCollins. So you work
HarperCollins.
Yes. So you work with the editors to tighten the text and make it strong.
And do you think in English?
Oh, do I think? Well, when
do
I write.
The question is, did you ever feel that? I mean, if you're.
Was the whether I was struggling with it?
If you're Bengali, I mean, I don't know.
I am a Bengali.
Right. So, I mean, don't you ever get this idea that I think in Bengali, Bengali is my nature, English would be my second nature. So a kind of psychological conflict between a foreign language. I mean, no matter. Well, and a basic.
This is one of the questions we used to get in our JNU entrance exams. Is English a foreign language, an Indian language, or a global language? So anyway, I used to always say that it's an Indian language. The thing is, you see, because of whatever our colonial heritage, etc., I studied in an English medium school. And I think, you see, the language of art chooses you. You don't choose it, you know. So I think that's why I'm kind of, so both the form and the language. So when I'm writing in English. I'm not translating. In many other contexts, I'm translating, you know. But not when I'm in front of a blank screen and I'm typing it out. I think the process is happening in English. Academic. That's when we were talking about academic things. And usually, what happens is the thesis is usually considered a bit draw. The thing is, the reason why I'm answering this question is because I was trained as an academic editor. I used to work in Routledge. So the thesis is still raw. You have to work a little bit with it and make it more book-like. And of course, the way you know, your model is model will obviously be other published academic books. So you have to, I think, a little bit of fine-tuning is necessary, and then you have to go to academic publishing.
But in that stage, suppose I want a freelance editor or someone else, can you tell me some place where I should go? Like, I don't know, in Delhi, where should you go?
I don't know if there are agencies like it, but I can suggest a few editors to you. We'll talk after the session. That I can do.
Okay.
Maybe
the question is about writing process. If we have some idea, okay, something, so we start writing. So, like, I don't think, like, do we have all thought with us, like, where we begin and then where the portion at the end? So, maybe you have written some book.
Yeah, I can tell you that, you know, I also read a lot of books on the writing process. So, because of my own curiosity as well. In my judgment, there are basically two kinds of writers, broadly, I mean, I'm saying. One kind of very meticulous, and they will plot it in their head before they sit to write even a single word. So I know the writer Ann Patchett, who I really love reading. She does that. So what Ann Patchett says is that she knows the last line before she sits down to begin writing the book. In my case, it doesn't happen like that at all, and there are other writers. It's only when you sit to write that the book begins to take shape. And then, of course, you go back. You restructure. It's a very complex thing to talk about, and of course, also writers are a bit superstitious. You know, you don't want to talk too much about it. You don't want to jinx it. So, you know,
yeah, it will be individual. Whatever works for you.
Hi, I'm Siddharth from Center for Russian Studies, First JNU. I've got two small questions. First is, how is the price of a book decided? Secondly,
how is the price of a book decided?
Okay. Secondly, supposing after a book is published, what percentage of the sales would a writer get to keep with himself? Like, will we have to bargain really with the publishing houses, or will they be kind enough to give us a few shares?
See, what happens is, I'll tell you, so whatever is the price of the book depends on the advance they're paying the authors, the paper, the thickness of the paper, the size of the book. So all these, all these things are basically taken into account, and then we do our costing, and that's how the price of the book is determined. Now, the royalty percentage that an author gets across the world, in India the current percentage is 8% for paperback. Whatever the price is, it will seem like daylight robbery to you if you just think about it like that. But you know, 50% of the profits, say a book is 100 rupees, 50 or 55% actually goes to the distributors and the retailers. So the rest of the 45 rupees or 50 rupees remains to the publisher, who has to give a certain percentage to the printing house, and you have to pay the rest for marketing. A lot of money goes into marketing, then you have to pay the editors, they have to run a publishing house. So basically, you're not left with great margins. I'm saying for a 100 rupee book. From that 50 rupees, and so from that, for a paperback, you will get 8 rupees for a book if a book costs 100 rupees. If it, and multiplied by the number of copies of the book that you sell. For a hardback, you'll get 10%, that is 10 rupees. There are some books for which an author, when he becomes more established, you get rising royalty.
Yeah, I'm sure Chetanmagat is paid
far more than 10%. So you will go up to 15%, sometimes 20%. Sometimes, say, if a book sells more than 10,000 copies, then an author will get a certain percentage. But it can't go beyond 15, 17, or 20 is the maximum, because otherwise it leaves nothing to the publisher.
The only exception is in the case of e-books, where the author, I think, gets 25%.
Yeah, so for e-books, what we have started usually is that we don't pay an advance in royalty, but we give directly to the authors, like whatever money comes. And the other thing is also, you can do other options like royalty sharing with the author, where the author is also investing in the initial, in the process, and when you have a royalty sharing process. There are many different ways to do these things, actually.
But basically the truth is that if you're not Chetan Bhagat and you're not selling hundreds of thousands of copies, as a writer, if you don't have a day job, it might be difficult to sell.
You can't survive without being a really best-selling writer. You can't really survive on in India at least. I think we have exhausted our questions. Thank you very much. As I said, it was a pleasure. This was my first visit to JNU, and I have always dreamt of studying here. And I'm very happy to come here for a completely different reason. I hope this talk was of some use to you, and that some of you will go on to become writers or editors. You're welcome. We are always looking
yes,
for editors.
I think we should take this up to tell them a little bit about a career in publishing.
Yeah, so that is, yes. I'll just very briefly say that publishing is looking up in India at this time, English language publishing, academic and trade. I think we need more and more smart young people to be in publishing, both in editorial and marketing. You know, people who are interested in books. I will not denude you about starting salaries, they are not good. But when you have been there for a few years, it does get better. And
you get lots of free books, if that's an incentive.
No, and the thing is that you are in the midst of so many writers, and I think the best thing about publishing is that you learn something new every day. You are reading books, you are interacting with people, you are interacting with the most intelligent people that you have in the current, you know, scenario, in the current in contemporary India, the kind of people we mix with, whether it's in politics, business, they are the best. So it's nice to work with the best brains in the country. And you do get
that's
to
a
learn
strong,
a lot.
That's a strong
yeah,
career.
You get to learn a lot. You will never be bored one day of your life. I think it is a very good career to have. And really, after you've been there for a few years, it's also rewarding in terms of money. So I think more and more young people should think about joining publishing.
Especially if you're passionate about books, because from what I have experienced, the publishing houses have great people, great editors who come mainly from the English departments. But I think you should also think of joining in the marketing departments, in sales, and
yeah,
other allied fields as well.
Yes. So thank you.
Thank you so much for coming. And I'm really honored to be here today. It feels